fascinating gadgets, gizmos, and gear-based technologies. Welcome to FGGGbT. Now, this is the show that takes your favorite fictional science and technology, and we make it a reality. Who does that? We do. We are the Brain Trust. I am the analytical mastermind, Daniel J. Glenn. With me, the physics phenom, Dr. Michael Dennett.
It is awesome to be here, Dan. As you all know and our audience knows, Spider-Man's my favorite, Batman a super close second. This movie almost switched it, Dan, for me. This was really cool.
Wow, that's serious stuff, Denon, which we're going to get to. Our history, the history you and I have with Spider-Man and Batman, it goes deep. It goes back. It's into antiquity as far as the internet goes. But we, as you know, speaking of a man from antiquity, we have to talk to our enigmatic engineer, our E-period enigmatic engineer, Ben Siepser. Ben, where are you broadcasting from this week?
Dan, tonight I'm just out on the town. You know, it's a very dark night. But there's this very strange spotlight up in the clouds. I don't know what's going on, but I think it'll be an exciting night.
I think it will be. If we keep these Batman puns going, it's going to be a night that it may be a dark night for our ratings. But you know, this episode's inspired by the Batman, and I'm with you, Denon. This was a great movie. And Ben, really quickly, we got an engineer. We got lots of gadgets. This might
we
sure be do. a gadget-o-rama. You got to be excited about that.
Absolutely. I always love to see, especially in this movie, how there are well-engineered bits that are shown, so we actually know they thought about how some of this stuff could work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love that. And this is our season 6 finale, guys. You know, we've been at this show almost as long as they've been making Batman remakes. So we're gonna make this a good one. But you know, Denon, I alluded to our history, the history you and I have, which goes all the way back to our days on Fascinating Fights. I think, if memory serves, the first episode we ever did together was Batman versus Spider-Man. So we just did Spider-Man. We're finishing up with Batman. It seems apropos, Denon.
Oh, it so does, Dan. And, you know, I think an incredible thing the audience needs to understand is there are two deep questions. Who would win in the fight? Hence the fascinating fights.
Right.
But also, who is our favorite? You know, not always. Your favorite doesn't always win, as we learned in a recent episode where your favorite is Hawkeye, and you did admit he'd probably be smashed by Thor. So,
yeah, absolutely. You know. Or the Hulk. Or the Hulk, by the way.
Yeah. So, or many of the Avengers.
We just keep going through the list.
Sure. But anyone but Hawkeye.
This movie, for me, captured at least what I think of as the essence of Batman. And I have to admit, everybody should know and remember, I'm not a huge comic book reader. So I'm not the one who gets up there and says, oh, this is nothing like the comic book. This is just like sort of my personal view of who Batman should be. And I felt this movie really was the best movie Batman.
Yeah.
And I'm going to stand by that.
Well, for those of you who don't know that you are not a comic book reader, you know, I put you on the spot last week and you let me know that. And it was quite an embarrassing moment for us all. But now that I know, I will only go to Ben when it comes to the comic book translation. But Ben, you must have loved this. I mean, they jump right in, right? Like what's great about this to me anyway, is that unlike the remakes before where you have to redo the Thomas and Martha. I almost said Mary Jane. Michelle Jones. The Thomas and Martha killing and how Batman. You know, we all know that story, right? And so this is just boom right in there. You know, Bruce is already kicking butt on the streets. And this is pretty dark. And you know, I just did a fascinating nouns episode on real life superheroes. And I think Batman, for at least for me, and I'm wondering about you too. He's a quintessential vigilante. You know, he's doing the right thing. He can almost sneak over into that villain line, but it's almost justified given the people that he's fighting. But he represents that dark part in all of us that wants to see justice by any means necessary. Now, is that true for you guys? I'm going to ask you, Ben, first, or is that just true for a guy like me who probably needs psychiatric help?
Well, I think justice is very important, and certainly Batman often delivers on that. But I also wonder,
Every time, Ben. You're a comic book reader. Every time he does it.
I think Batman makes mistakes here and there.
Maybe.
But what I also found was really interesting in this movie especially was how the mayor-elect comes up to Bruce Wayne and asks him for support from a, charity, from a, you know, from, you know, a justice in terms of financial justice for the city kind of thing. And he kind of blows her off. And I got, you know, made me kind of think about, why doesn't Bruce Wayne, as Mr. Wayne, also do more to support the city and not just go around beating up criminals?
You know, so for me, you know, one of the things I loved about this movie is I do really love this tension between what this movie, I think, did very well was vengeance versus truly being a superhero. And, you know, Dan, to your point, we all know the origin story of his parents getting killed and then he becomes Batman. But this was, to me, the origin story of going from just about vengeance, which he calls himself vengeance in most of the early movie. And it ends with him realizing, wait a minute, I can't be just about vengeance if I'm going to help my city. I thought, to me, this was an awesome kind of variation on the origin story for Batman in that way. It gave us a new insight into his psyche.
Yeah, I think that's right. And I think they did a lot of cool things. You know, this was very similar to, you know, what we talked about with Spider-Man last week. And I have to mention this because I gave Spider-Man such a hard time. And I want to apologize to Zendaya and her entire family for giving her such a hard time. I'm sure she's wonderful to hang out with, just not Mary Jane. But the cast of characters here is the opposite, guys. I thought that this really worked well. You know, you have the similar characters. You kind of futzed around with it a little bit, but it all kind of worked. And I loved, Jeffrey Wright in Westworld is great, but he's incredible as Jim Gordon here fighting against all the corrupt cops. And his relationship with Batman I thought was great. I think this is, you know, a classic example of how you can get it right when the comic books have built that kind of connection. And the other thing here, Ben, I'm looking at you here. You didn't like Mary Jane. You said it was an old name. Alfred, that's pretty old too. I think that he's Alan Frederick in this one. He's not technically Alfred. Do you feel better about that?
I didn't even catch that, but I kind of like that. You know, it's a little fun. But at the same time, I also feel like the British names are still in the past. So, you know, it's okay to leave Alfred in there.
Well, you didn't catch it because I completely made it up for this show here. But before we move on, you know, I want to mention, you know, we also did a Batman 66 episode of Fascinating Fights versus Batman 66 versus Inspector Gadget. I'm going to put those on the website. And again, I did a Fascinating Nouns episode on Batman 66, the series, with a guy named Robert Garcia, a historian. I'm going to put links to that all on the website. But we're going to move away from Batman 66, guys, because as you know, that is a very different version than what we see here. This is very dark. And it's very real. You know, a lot of this technology seems real, it seems gritty, but it seems based in, it can happen is what I'm saying. You could build this. It's, you know, I don't want to keep saying real, but that seems to be the quintessential piece here. What do you think, Denon?
The reality of this is what really was the final kind of nail that made me excited about this and did not put the movie in a coffin, to mix a metaphor.
Yeah. You know, I was wondering where you're going with that, but you nailed it.
Thank you. It just, you know, we watch so many of these shows and movies where there's a core that's real, reality, easy to explain, and there's stuff. We're the masterminds of this. We can explain anything and make it real. Right. This movie almost makes it too easy for us, Dan. It is just so good at being really, really close or actually accurate. I think between the three of us in our prep, we found maybe only two moments that make us nervous. Our audience may find more. That's a pretty, pretty good hit rate.
Yeah, I agree. I can't agree with you more on that one.
Yeah, I what's really cool about the whole movie, but especially the gadgets that we mentioned before, is you really see the physicality of them in how they would work. You see, you know, the grappling hook, not doing crazy things with swinging and stuff. He just, you know, uses it to rappel. He uses it as an elevator thing. You know, it works out. You know, he has a nice catch for it. So he's not like holding onto it with his fingers. It like, you know, slots into his arm guards, which probably have like a whole set of joints to connect it to his center of mass. You know, there's all this stuff in there that makes sense and makes it realistic, which I really, really appreciated.
And I have to add one thing, Dan. I loved that he built it all. I mean, I know I'm not the engineer in the group, but I'm a wannabe engineer at times. And just watching the Batcave and the parts laid out, right? Like they would show you basically him building things, including like parts of his motorcycle. And I believe there was even a scene with parts of the car. He was clearly working on the car, you know. So I was just like, this is cool. He's not, you know, paying some rich corporation or stealing from his own rich corporation to get his tools like maybe another Batman movie did that we won't mention here. Right? this was hardcore nitty-gritty work that he had to do, which meant he understood his equipment, knew its limitations, and knew how to use it. So I was just really excited by like the scenes in the Batcave, which doesn't happen often, right?
No, it doesn't. And I'm glad you mentioned that because I love the Batcave, but I also love how he gets to the Batcave. You know, I went up to the Bronson Caves here in Los Angeles where the original Batman 66 Batcave is, and it's a small little tunnel. But here he uses an old subway tunnel, which is great because there are so many, you know, we forget that a city like, well, Gotham City is basically dystopia New York. And in a city that big and that old, you do have this infrastructure, these abandoned tunnels and subway systems that are, they're not used unless you're Batman. And I love that he uses a subway tunnel to get there. There's this great documentary called Dark Days about the mole people in I don't know, that may be a derogatory term now. The movie was made a while ago, so I apologize to any mole people listening. But it's big enough and forgotten enough where people can live down there, and a great way to hide an entrance to a bat cave. This was great to me. I love this use of the New York infrastructure.
I really enjoyed it. I have to admit, I this is not a criticism. I did miss the mansion way out in the outskirts of the city and the country, but apparently, you know, that became an orphanage. So what are you going to do? And you know, I loved the times where they jumped through waterfalls with the Batmobiles, because clearly a waterfall. I mean, we know from every adventure movie you've ever watched, the waterfall is the best way to hide anything, whether it's secret treasure or your Batcave.
No one
ever thinks to look behind the waterfall, Dan. Like, that's just not what you're going to do. But I do like this twist. I love it being right in the middle of the city, and I love the subway tunnels.
Yeah.
Well, I also like that. I think, to me, it's a more realistic way to hide something in this era. I don't know how a drone doesn't just follow the Batmobile back to the Batcave when it's out in the woods and nothing's going on. Whereas, you know, if you dive down into a subway tunnel and you don't have the cameras on down there because you're Batman and you hacked the surveillance system, of course you can get lost. You can lose somebody down there. It's a lot easier. Drones aren't going to be able to follow you as easily. It makes a lot more sense in my mind in the modern era.
Yeah, it's no Wi-Fi getting through all that concrete. But you mentioned hiding, which is interesting because this moves us on to one of my favorite parts of this particular movie. As a lead in here, you know, this movie, again, it's really gritty. It's a much more dangerous world because you have the Riddler. He's basically a serial killer, and that is so different from the Batman 66, you know, Frank Gorshin, the guy that I dressed up as a kid. I was the Riddler for Halloween. I would not be this Riddler for Halloween. People would have me committed. But I love that, you know, we've got these ciphers. If you're watching, you know, the YouTube version, you can see that I have the Zodiac Killer 340 character cipher behind me. And this is important because I came across this interesting article, guys, that really compares the Riddler to the Zodiac Killer, and this was not by accident. This was on purpose, and so it's a very interesting comparison. And really quickly about ciphers, let's talk about ciphers. I want to get your opinion on ciphers in general before we go into some of the details about this one. Because Dennett, I'm curious. You know, you seem like a guy who likes puzzles. You know, if you feel like a Wordle man to me, what do you think about these in general?
Well, first of all, I grew up loving ciphers. I mean, one of the most exciting moments in my life was when I learned about breaking simple ciphers by looking at the, you know, letters that are most popular, you know, find the E's, the S's, the T's, and do that. And you can work your way through. I like making simple ciphers. I also love the fact that I discovered, you know, lemon juice makes really good invisible ink. Right. I really thought I was going to be a spy until I learned I had no poker face and couldn't lie.
Can I ask you a question, Dennett? Can I ask you a quick question? So yes, when you're doing the ciphers, you know, I feel like it's the same strategy with Wheel of Fortune, right? R-S-T-L-N-E. Did that ever come into play when you were, you know, with those substitutions, you know?
Oh, yeah. No, all the time. I use that all the time. I was never really good at Wheel of Fortune because I really, when I'm on the spot, I can't think of the word that fills in. And this is my problem with Wordle. I very often will have one letter left. and guess five words that work in the English language, but not the one that meets the Wordle. So, right. You know.
Always a problem. You got to meet the Wordle, Dennett.
Yeah, I mean, there are problems. But ciphers themselves, and I loved, as a kid, learning the difference between cipher and code. Mm-hmm. Right? Where you have a cipher that's a letter replacement, maybe incredibly complicated one, and you're actually writing English words in a new set of symbols or letters versus a code where you really actually need the code book and you need to know every word to every word and just the challenges of that. So no, that whole area is absolutely fascinating to me. Yeah. I suspect it's the same for Ben. He looks a lot like a secret spy code person as well.
You look like a daily jumble man, Ben. Yeah, I can see you doing that.
Well, I would do the jumble when I was at home and there's an actual paper there. Help the family with it. But I do the Wordle and the Quartles and the Octordles and all those as well. So I think what's interesting, though, is this difference between ciphering and coding, as Denon alluded to. Because what's fascinating about what the Riddler does and what the Zodiac Killer does is it's substitution. You're changing one letter to another, and there's patterns and there's transpositions and all this stuff to mix things around. But it's still not how encryption works. It's not where you have basically a random number that you're adding on to the other, your message, and just making complete indecipherable garbage, as it were. And so it's this fascinating thing where a cipher is always eventually to some degree solvable because there's always a pattern. Mm-hmm. And that's what's fascinating to me about this Zodiac puzzle is it took 50 years to find the crazy pattern the Zodiac mm-hmm. killer put into it, but it still was a pattern that eventually was able to be figured out.
Yeah, well, you know, and I like that you mentioned that because it was figured out. It was 51 years, Ben, which is important. 50, I think it was actually 52, because this came out in 1969, basically the year that the United States ended. That was a really good and bad year. 69 was a very strange year. But, you know, you have this, you know, the 340 character cipher, it was cracked, you know, last year by a man named David Ornichak and a group of people. He wasn't the only one. But he said something really interesting in an article I'm going to put up on the website, which was that this particular code, with the computations we have now, it was so computationally, the resources required to crack this were so heavy that nobody in 1969 could have cracked it. Now, I'm guessing his guess is that the fact that it stumped people for so long means that even the Zodiac Killer was not aware of just how difficult the code was that he made, which is incredibly impressive. Now, I know, Ben, you said that this wasn't like digital encryption, but mm-hmm. in some ways, it's like analog encryption. And, you know, this code survived what is essentially the analog version of a brute force attack for 50 plus years. That's pretty incredible.
Yeah, absolutely. You know? But what's interesting about it is that once you know the trick, it was easy to decipher. And so there's this fascinating thing that he just picked a way to do the cipher that was just really complicated. And there's gazillions of different ways he could have done it. And because of that, it stood up for a very, very long time. It's interesting that there's different ways to come to a long-term unsolvable problem like that.
Well, I also think, Ben, what it really shows is one of these challenges of algorithms and math, right? If you mm-hmm. know the rules, it's always easy.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you don't know the rules, it can often be impossible. This is why as a child, I don't know how many of you had to do this. I hated the math homework where they gave you a sequence of a bunch of numbers and asked you to say what was next. Because I was always going down the wrong path, right? Mm-hmm. And like all of that was like there could have been lots of rules that they were using. And if you knew the rule, yeah, it was obvious. And the teacher always knew the rule, which was just not fair in my mind, right?
Of course not.
And then some of these aren't even about math. I don't know if you've ever seen it. Some of them, they're in alphabetical order or something, right? You have to like know that they're using the spelling of the numbers, not the actual numbers themselves. And then you're mixing English and math. And these are the type of ciphers, to your point, Dan, it's an analog rule, right? It's an analog encryption. And I think that's a fascinating area of this space.
Yeah, school's a rigged system, Den, and you're not going to beat it. And you know, you're right. I mean, it's funny when you said that, Ben, like it was easy once you figured it out. It's like, well, yeah, everything is. You know, once you know, the trick is figuring out the trick.
The trick. Yeah, well, but what's interesting is modern encryption, if you know the trick, it doesn't matter. And so that's the difference between ciphering and encrypting, is that there is no trick in encrypting. It's just the math.
Right. Yeah. Okay. That makes sense. Well, and you know, and I like that you brought up the distinction. I think Denon actually brought up the distinction, but you continued it on, which was the difference between, you know, codes and ciphers. Because one of the other things that I just want to mention, because I love this particular historical fact, and I don't think these people got enough. I don't think they have quite enough recognition. And that's the World War II code talkers, where the United States government used, you know, the indigenous people's languages, you know, the Comanche, the Hopi, the Navajo. You know, that's just to name a few. There's a whole list of people who dedicated their services to the government. And, you know, they were basically creating a code in languages that were so different than, you know, the Romance languages or basically anything that was around at the time, because the structure was so foreign that you needed to know the language in order to figure it out. And this was an incredible advantage to us. And, you know, if you don't know my thoughts on this, the fact that any of the Native Americans would have helped the United States government do anything is a testament to just how honorable and great that they were. But this is a fascinating piece of American history.
Yeah.
No, I love it, Dan. And it goes to, you know, that language thing. I think we forget. And I, first of all, agree with you. Absolutely amazing on all angles that. But it's also just showing that this breaking languages that are lost is basically code breaking. And when, you know, trying to understand Egyptian hieroglyphs, how key it was to have a Rosetta Stone, right, where you actually had a language you knew.
Mm-hmm.
Once you start breaking it, right, that then all this other stuff follows. It does make me wonder how much of Egyptian hieroglyphics we really got right. And, you know, we read things and think it's something fancy, and it's really, you know, Susie's a loser. Get her out of my house. You know?
Well, you think about it, like the Rosetta Stone, we don't know that it was done by any official organization. It could have been someone's like notes at home, you know, for school, right? Like just deciphering, you know, we don't know. It could have been shorthand. That's a really interesting point then. And who created the Rosetta Stone? Was it Jonathan Rosetta? Was it Susie Rosetta? We don't actually know. And we don't know what it was for. It's a great point.
And you know, it really comes down to a lot of this encryption stuff. You know, I think about it. We're at a stage, people are always hear about quantum computing. And to Ben's comment, you know, where a lot of modern encryption is just math that our computers can't break right now. Mm-hmm. Quantum computing is someday going to, in principle, allow us to break the math we do now. But then we'd have to create new math that can't break. So it's an interesting ongoing arms race at some level in this space of encryption and coding.
Denon brings up a great point with this quantum computing. And it just goes to show the whole concept of you can't keep secrets from the future. All codes can eventually be broken, whether it's a cipher like the Zodiac Killer. Eventually, you can throw enough Mathematica at it to figure out the substitution patterns and things and get what the Zodiac Killer was saying, just like you can throw enough quantum computing at the modern internet backbone encryption and it will break, and it will break very quickly if the theories of quantum encryption or quantum decryption pan out. And it's a scary thing, because all of a sudden, if that works, you know, all of a sudden every bank transaction's in the clear, every medical record, everything that's ever been encrypted will pretty much break right away if quantum decryption works out the way we think it might.
You know, and actually, interestingly, Ben, I know you pointed out that we're not safe from the future. I think if anyone has been watching this show every episode, they know we're also not safe from the past, because in a galaxy far, far away a long time ago, you know, R2-D2 could break anything just by plugging his little tube into the computer system. So nothing's safe from the past either, Dan. Right. Both directions are important dangerous.
Yeah, and if you're running low on Mathematica that you want to throw at a problem, I'm going to we're going to build a store here, and you're going to buy Mathematica by the ounce, but I don't know how they sell it, but we're going to have some for you.
Usually by the software license.
By the software license.
Wait, does it come by the cup, Dan?
It's an interesting point, because we can put it next to the cups, next to the mugs on the FGGGbt.com/merch.
Yeah. Or whether it's cups or water bottles, you can get everything you need on the FGGGbt merch store.
It's very important, whether it's Mathematica mugs or water bottles. It's their fgggbt.com/merch. I keep saying backslash. I've been corrected. I'm going to work it in there, slash. And before we, you know, before we move away from this, I want to mention one other thing here, which I think is really fun, is if you like ciphers and you want clues and you don't want to do Wordle, if you think it's if it's too trendy, if it's too pop culture for you, don't worry. There's lots of great books out there that actually have ciphers in them. Now, these are in the past. I just mentioned Wordle, which is very new, so I'm gonna go back 20 years and talk about a couple of examples. when I was in college, David Blaine's book Mysterious Stranger came out, which I loved that book, and in it is a cipher, and you win $100,000 if you figure it out. Now, don't try to figure it out now because it's, you know, solved in 2004, but it's a really fun thing to add to a book as a little marketing scheme. And of course, there's the Forrest Fenn mystery, which was solved roughly in 2020. It was confirmed the guy didn't come forward, and then he came forward later, but this exists out there. It's a lot of fun, and you know, it's a cool way to sell a book, I guess. But you know what is not cool? We're gonna move from something fun to something absolutely terrible and rooted in reality really quickly. As you, Ben, you mentioned the movie bomb, that you would have a hard time figuring out something if it was strapped around your neck. And you know, in this movie, we see a bomb around the DA's neck as he's, you know, trying to, he's got the phone and he's, you know, scrambling to figure it out. There's a movie called Evil Genius. I'm promoting two documentaries here where this actually happened, where someone created a bomb, put it around a man's neck, and had him rob a bank. This is pretty crazy, but it shows you the ingenuity and actually how close and how much this particular movie is just, it's inspired by real life. And I don't know, Denon, if that's scary or, you know, fun from a technological standpoint.
Well, this particular one is unfortunately scary, obviously, but what's also... Sure.
I give you like softball there. Yeah, I want to make that clear. That I gave you softball. That was an easy one, yeah. Yeah, it's either scary. It's not fun. Okay, yeah. That's my riddle.
But again, mm-hmm. What's interesting about it is the choice that people made in the movie to make this at the right level in my mind. I mean, let's face it, blowing up somebody with a bomb around their neck is never fun. Mm-mm. But it's also usually in a movie of this style, when the bomb goes off, I would argue the explosion would be way bigger than justified by the size of the bomb used. And in this case, I felt like, oh, okay, you know, there's an explosion. Batman is knocked back and he's sort of knocked unconscious. He's running a little bit away from it. But I felt, not being an explosive expert, to be honest, but I still felt that the explosion was appropriate to the size of the bomb. I do completely agree with Ben. I don't know. Well, Batman was solving most of the riddles. He did not actually have the bomb around his neck. That may have helped.
Quite a bit, I would imagine. I may have mentioned this. Not a small, yeah. That's not a small detail to overlook, then. And I think that is very important.
I mean, I think I've shared it in the past in the show. I am not the best under pressure at answering questions. I'm great in formats like this, you know, because there's no pressure here. We're just chatting. But, you know, put me in, like, you know, a high school bowl situation, and I failed to answer any question because there was a timer and a buzzer. I feel like a bomb would only make it worse. I'm with Ben on that.
Well, I will tell you before, I want to get Ben's thoughts on this, but I do want to mention, since we're going back in history, you may not be an explosion expert, Denon, but you did reveal that you are a borderline pyromaniac, which, yes. Superhero, supervillain, that's the question on you.
No, this is true, but let's leave that topic, Dan, and go to Ben. All right.
Fair enough. All right, Ben, what do you think about this? So is this something you've created? Hopefully not.
No. It's some pretty sketchy stuff from an ethical standpoint, obviously.
To say the least, yeah.
I mean, you know, obviously we need to do something about corrupt DAs, but strapping bombs to their necks is probably not the right approach.
Yeah, that's probably right.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting because they showed some interesting technology with this, obviously. You know, I think we all thought that as soon as he answered the phone, it would blow up. You know, it was interesting that that wasn't, in fact, how it worked. There was clearly some other extra transmitter, or maybe it was, you know, Bluetooth connected to the phone or something. But it just goes to show that there's a lot of, you know, technology here, like making a bomb that you can trigger wirelessly at the most dramatic point when necessary. You know, that's a tricky thing. What I really also wonder is, it seemed like the DA was sitting there for a very long time. I gotta wonder, how was the Riddler always ready to answer the phone right away? Like, did he was he just standing off screen for like 7 hours waiting for the phone to be answered? That's some serious stamina right there.
And no voicemail kicking in, but let's not squabble over details. But it is an interesting point to think about.
He was at the event. I think we get a shot of him before we know that that's who he is up in the balcony.
I think he
was tracking this, which is kind of clever. And actually, you know, your comment about, you know, the technology and being ready and the wireless and the Bluetooth, you know, it was really, it's the complexity of it that's part of the fascination of this.
Yeah.
But I also want to say, Dan, this is the one moment in the movie where I found it interesting. You know, riddles are tricky things. Mm-hmm. And I felt the three riddles transitioned from riddles to interrogation questions, right? It was an interesting moment where the Riddler went a little less riddly.
And riddles are tricky if you're not the analytical mastermind. I just want to make that point before Ben jumps in here.
Riddles are definitely tricky, but I think it really just goes to show that the Riddler is also an engineer, or at least a software engineer. Because I like Denon's mention about voicemail. This phone was ringing for hours. So clearly, this is all like some app he wrote where it can ring for hours and not go to voicemail, not give up. You know, there's some interesting tech there that just goes to show that the Riddler is not just a cipher writer, not just a riddle maker. He also he's got some real tech skills going on, too.
Yeah. And it would be out of character for me not to mention that it was I who pointed out the voicemail thing and not Dennett.
So that must be
said, or I will get a lot of hate mail for not living into my character.
I was going to put that in my errors and additions, Dan. If you missed that.
So I got to lean into that.
I was holding on to that one.
Well, and I will tell you, you know, speaking of, you know, obviously I love being right, but another thing that I love that you guys know is Wile E. Coyote. So we're going to move from blowing a bomb on someone's head to becoming a bomb yourself, because no one blows themselves up more than Wile E. Coyote. But the particular comparison in this movie is that incredible the flying suit that Batman wears. Like, how great is that? And, you know, for those of you who have seen us live at Comic-Con or several of the other conventions that we do live events, you will know we did an episode on the Acme product catalog. And this will come as no surprise to the two of you. I almost said the three of you as I'm looking at the two of you, which is that particular product that Wile E. Coyote buys is called Batman's Outfit. Again, the people who did this movie, a lot of research here, Denon.
No, well, it just goes to show how awesome the creators of this film were to understand and make that reference. I'm sure it's an explicit reference to Wile E. Coyote for all of us, you know, lovers out there of the great genius himself. But I will say, this is a moment I loved because, you know, you have Batman in some other movies, you know, gliding with his wings through various fancy technology that's very hard to imagine building. And supporting flight. We know we have suits, base jumping suits, glider suits. And I'm not an expert in design of suits, but the fact that it's a basic principle and it would look something like this, if not exactly this, I found really cool. I really appreciated that. I thought, again, this may be one of those moments that it gets a little tricky near the end. One of the few potential failures of the movie, but overall, way closer, more inaccurate to some other ways Batman flies.
Yeah.
And he wipes out at the end, which you don't see very often.
That is the realistic part of the ending.
I think what was really interesting about it is it goes back to the whole Batman is engineering and tinkering himself system, because it really looks like he bought an off-the-shelf wingsuit, which is, you know, a thing that skydivers use to have more control while they're skydiving, and painted it black. Or, well, he probably just bought the black one and fitted it into the rest of his bat suit. You know, that's just, you know, that's a real thing that you can get and go jump out of a plane with. And then I love that, you know, he's kind of out of control, just like you are when you really use these things. And he pops a drogue chute to slow down, which is really how you stabilize yourself and slow yourself down with these things. Sure. And then foolishly, he does it right in front of a bridge and should have killed himself. But, you know, it just goes to show how rigid and shock absorbing the rest of the suit must be that he didn't get crumpled when he hit the underside of the bridge.
Yeah, no, it's just a well-designed suit. And it's just bad luck that the bridge was there. That was not his fault.
Yeah.
You know, you'd think he'd be used to the elevated train rails being all over the place by now, but I guess not.
Well, I will say that, you know, you mentioned he probably has it under the suit. It's a little bulky. It's very baggy. It's very like early 90s MC Hammery baggy look. But that's one of those things that you want to have and not need instead of need and not have it. I mean, we.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, exactly.
There. What I love about this is that, you know, he's Batman. Right. And a bat is a mammal that can fly, which is I love going to the zoo and seeing bats. They're just I think they're so incredible. They're really cute, too. But there's a lot of things that and a bat can actually fly. And obviously he's gliding here. And what I love is there are so many other mammals that glide and use extra skin. They've, you know, evolved the extra skin to do that. Flying squirrels might be the most adorable of that group. I'm going to put, you know, a video on the website of some flying squirrels. But also, this is kind of cool, guys. And this is very Batman-like. In Indonesia, there's gliding snakes. And we've talked about this before, but snakes are a little different when they fly. The way they, I think it's undulate. Is that the word? They move back and forth.
Right.
They swim through the air, which is really bizarre. One of the things they chase after is a flying dragon, like a little lizard, not an actual dragon, obviously, but you know, like a little kimono dragon kind of, and it glides as well to get away from the flying snake. So in Indonesia, you've got several non-birds gliding and flying after each other through the trees, which is just, it tells you just how great nature is, you know, guys.
And as we say, nature is something's technology or something, I think. Isn't there a famous quote there?
I believe it was the great analytical mastermind, Daniel J. Glenn, who once said, biology is nature's technology. And in no case have we ever worked on or looked at, is it more true than right there in Indonesia?
See, I knew there was a quote there, Dan. I knew there was.
Yeah.
You nailed it.
It just goes to show the escalation of evolution where, you know, the lizards evolve to glide, and at the same time, the snakes are evolving a way to spread out their ribs and glide after them. You know, as one animal figures out a way to get away from something, another animal evolves a way to catch them still. So it's fascinating stuff how all these co-evolution things happen out there in nature.
It's kind of like the future can break any code we have now. Like, you evolve a way to fly away, somebody else evolves a way to catch you.
Yeah, well, something will almost always evolve a way to catch you. It might not be flying, but, you know, I'm reminded of the snakes that hang out at the entrance of bat caves and just snatch the bats out of the air. Those snakes don't fly. They're just really sensitive and fast.
Holy cow. I've never heard of that before. That's awful. Why is that not a Batman villain? That's incredible. Actually, that's really good. I mean, it's a literal arms race out there, guys, just to continue our terrible puns from earlier. But, you know, when we're talking about gliding, I remember one of the first non-air gliding things that I ever learned about was when I was in driver's ed and hydroplaning. You know, where you can basically your car's gliding along the road. And we see that in this movie, this great car chase scene with the Batmobile chasing after the Penguin. And it's raining pretty heavily. And somehow these vehicles are maintaining just, you know, NASCAR level handling out there in the rain, which is kind of incredible because, you know, I remember learning in driver's ed that you can hydroplane. Your car can literally be a boat in a tenth of an inch of water, 0.3 centimeters, going at only 50 miles an hour. The physics don't seem right about that, Denon. It seems too easy, and that makes it very scary.
Well, you know, as we all know, I am an experimentalist. My specialty is foam. I don't know what it has to do with this particular question, but I thought I'd mention it. You know,
that is the worst foam reference ever. You have no reason for it. You better come back to foam, Denon. Better fill those tires or something.
Well, I will say some foam in this story would have been very helpful because there is a dangerous ending to it. In high school, I managed to hydroplane going about 20 miles an hour. And that was due to tires that were probably slicker than ice. My friend and I had forgot my tie that I needed for the photo for the soccer team. So I took the liberty of leaving school in the middle of the day. Not the wisest move. Hydroplane through a stoplight. Hitting another woman who was also had left school when she wasn't her car.
I hope she was in a car at the time.
Her car was a tank. It just like dented her door. Nobody was injured. And we did discover that the VW bug I owned, the seat was not actually held in place, the passenger seat, by anything other than rust, because the seat came free. My friend hit the windshield, no damage, and then the seat fell over backwards, and he was lying on his back. So a little bit of foam, Dan, would have really helped in this situation.
That's awful. Yeah. And the Volkswagen bug, you know, it famously has the trunk in the front. So that crushed the I mean.
Well, no, but the gas tank is also in the front. And so I remember sitting there going, do not explode. Do not explode. That was my only thought. Do not explode. I tell this story because the hydroplaning is very dangerous. It's very interesting. It was literally, I was going about 20 because I'd come from a stop sign and the car didn't accelerate very fast. But the interesting comment was when my mom tried to convince the police officer not to give me a ticket for running a red light, which technically I did. I slid through a red light. I don't know, you know, if that's running it. The officer was, that's fine, ma'am. I could just give him a ticket for driving too fast for conditions. Which ticket would you like him to have? So I guess it was an either or, a ticket for the hydroplaning or a ticket for running the red light. But Dan, you're absolutely right. hydroplaning is dangerous. The speed you can go safely clearly depends on your tires. So your 50-mile-an-hour quote, if you get bald enough tires, that number goes down. I'm just saying.
That's crazy.
I mean, it goes to show the kind of the physics and the engineering of it. Because, you know, Den talks about bald tires, right? Tires without tread. It's the tread that keeps you from hydroplaning. And the more channels you have in your tires, the faster you can go without hydroplane. I remember all these tire commercials from when I was younger showing, you know, the wire wicking through the channels on the tires and, you know, this will be the safest, you know, tire ever and you can trust your, you know, infant to it kind of stuff. but it's a fascinating thing because, you know, I would hope that, you know, Batman, knowing he lives in a rainy place, you know, where there's always clouds, so the bat signal can always be projected against a skybox that is where it's visible. I hope he has some very heavy, aggressive off-road tires on the Batmobile so that he doesn't hydroplane while he's chasing the penguin. And the penguin, you know, being, you know, an aquatic creature, he must also know. So that's why he didn't hydroplane either.
Well, I was going to say, Ben, I think the penguin just got lucky. I think Batman was designed for this. And so, Dan, to your point, hydroplaning, the nice thing about it is if you really understand the physics and the engineering, you can design against it because it really is impressive how solid a thin layer of water can get. And when you compress it between the tire and the road, there is basically no friction, right? And it really fluid technically, and not just technically, actually is basically an incompressible body, unlike gas. And we forget that water just can't be compressed. And so if you have a perfectly smooth, flat, bald tire like I did, you literally just press the water and, it doesn't go anywhere, and you're lifted off the ground and you hydroplane. So kind of a scary situation.
Well, I want to see if there's any fixes we can do here, guys, really quickly. So is there a way to engineer? I mean, it's if you can't compress water, obviously you got to move it out of the way, you know. Is there a way to do it besides tread? Does the weight of the car do anything? I mean, could we engineer a way for the Batmobile, given the conditions that Batman's always under, to have a situation where he's never going to hydroplane? Is that possible?
Well, I mean, hydroplane is all about not having water under the tires. So one thought I have is you use the engine, you know, he's got this jet engine that blows air really fast. You know, maybe you do some kind of air squeegee in front of the wheels with your jet exhaust to clear, you know, kind of like Moses parting the Red Sea, get the water out of the way of the wheels.
Oh, yeah, I think that's the easiest. And you know, is the air blowing? I also wonder if, you know, he's got an incredibly hot car because of the jet engine. Instant vaporization of the water might be another way to go, where you're just basically creating such heat that the tires can withstand it. There's a little tire engineering there. You don't want to melt your tire while you're accidentally vaporizing the water. And by vaporize, I don't mean the standard science fiction turn to dust. I mean literally turn it to water vapor. Yeah.
Well, and then you'll get a cool steam effect as you drive through. So
yeah.
That would be pretty cool. I mean, those are great fixes for sure.
I mean, you could also just have a mechanical squeegee in front of each tire. With right. a little snowplow. Yeah,
that just seems a little more dangerous and slow. That worried me. I was trying to picture that in my head, Ben, little windshield wipers in front of your tires and what impact they would have on your driving speed.
I mean, the trick with that is how you do it without having them drag and catch and blow up, especially on a probably not well maintained Gotham freeway, because you know, I don't know. I don't think the roads are super great shape over there.
Well, I will tell you, I think, and I could be wrong here, but I believe the Acme product catalog does have a set of squeegees for your tires. But as we've seen, it may not be something that we want to use. And it's possible that it may show up on our merch store. We'll have to see. But until then, if there's anything that we've missed, if there's anything that you want to see from the Acme product catalog, let's talk about it here. Anything that we missed. This is our Errors, Additions, and Omissions section. Things we wanted to talk about but we didn't quite get to. Denon, is there anything about the Batman that you wanted to talk about that we didn't quite get to?
Well, two quick things. One is just kind of a style choice. I love the fact when movies are able to do previews that don't let me know what's going to happen in the movie.
Impossible, but go ahead.
No, but I think this preview, I know you don't watch previews, Dan, because you don't want spoilers. This particular set of previews set up a very different movie. They chose to make it look like a violent action movie, not an intellectual puzzle-solving Riddler movie. So I really appreciated that. When I went in and watched it, I was like, whoa, this is not the movie you advertised. It's a way better one. I did not have high hopes for this movie, and I came out of it really liking it. So props to the appropriate use of previews. Two, I really love, you know, what gets me is when really smart good guys have to do something super stupid for the bad guy to have any chance so that you have a movie, right? Like, think of how many times the movie you went, well, that wouldn't really happen. But I guess if it didn't, we wouldn't have a movie, right? Like, you know,
right.
And in this case, spoiler alert, you know, the big thing was Batman didn't recognize a carpet tool. And you know what? That's very believable. You know, there is he knows a lot, but he doesn't know everything. And carpet tools are certainly in the category of stuff I would not necessarily expect Batman to know. And it takes the crazy sidekick guy who has a brother who's who lays carpet to go, hey, that's a carpet tool, right? You know, I love when the mistake the good guy makes is very believable. And my third final one, excellent use of grappling hooks in battle. Like the grappling hook Batman had, I mean, Ben already talked about the realistic use for climbing. He wasn't swinging. He wasn't doing crazy things. But he had these grappling hooks on his suit that had some power. And he used them when fighting people to do the classic non-lethal Batman fighting. Haven't seen such good use of grappling hooks in a long time. So I actually had three. I usually only have one or two. I got very excited by this movie, Dan.
You absolutely did. Well, I will tell you that Batman nor Bruce Wayne are a man of the people. So the fact that he doesn't know about interior upholstery is not surprising.
Exactly.
And you said you liked the trailers, but in fact, the marketing people didn't do their job because they sold a movie that it wasn't actually the right movie.
I liked it. I love being surprised. I'm an odd duck. Fair. What can I say?
No, that's fair enough. Okay. Well, I could go on about the silly marketing people, but what about you, Ben? Is there anything about this movie that we didn't talk about that we just make it into?
Well, I mean, I think it all comes down to the climax at the, you know, the Gotham arena. Mm-hmm. First of all, I appreciate that the terrorists with the guns, they're still following their OSHA rules. They're tying in to the cables so that if they slip, they don't fall to their deaths, which also makes it easy for Batman to dispatch them without killing them. Right. I appreciated that. But what was also interesting about that is Batman enters by like exploding the entire glass ceiling. And I don't know about you guys, but I don't think it's a good idea to drop a bunch of glass shards like 100, 200 feet onto a crowd below. I don't think that was a good way to enter the arena per se. But
as it's filled with water, by the way.
It's safety glass. It's not sharp. It's all still rounded when you explode it. Yeah. It's right. That's how they design arenas.
That's exactly right. Well, I mean, it tells you how just blue collar this movie is, right? This movie is for the common man. And I like that. I like that they follow their OSHA rules. I've got some stuff here, guys. You're not going to believe this, but I've got three corrections And actually, I'm going to correct you first, Denon. It is true. I've confirmed it that if a tree falls in the woods and no one is around to hear it, it does not make a sound. I just wanted to confirm that for everyone listening.
Okay.
And I got one for you, Ben. According to the Baby Center, and I want to, people who haven't heard this, you know, I said Michelle Jones is a goofy name. Ben said no one names their kid Mary Jane anymore. And we left it at that. Well, I'm not leaving it at that, Ben. Okay. According to the Baby Center, which is the authority on baby names, I can only assume because it proves my point, is that Mary, the name Mary, is at 210 rankings of all time. Michelle is at 249. Just going to say that. The Bump, which is another another website about baby names, has Mary at 308 and Michelle at 687. So I'm going to, and but Jane.
Does any of them have Jane as a middle name?
I'm getting to it, Denon.
Okay.
Jane is at 571, which is still ahead of Michelle. So I rest my case on that. And the other thing is I want to correct something that I said. I'm hitting everybody today. And that is a chrononaut is the official term for a time traveler. I did not nail that before. But is anything else that we missed? If anyone else has...
By the way, Dad, did you call him a chrono donut or something? What was your mistake?
Oh, no, I don't know, but a cronut is pretty delicious. This is a cronaut. Okay. Very different. Okay. Very different than... I know chocolate chips are your arena. If I had said cronut, I know you would have caught me earlier. Cronaut. Is officially a time traveler. But if we missed chrononaut, someone, one iteration of what we said is correct. I'm going to let you guys choose which one it is. That's our riddle. That's our puzzle for the episode. But is there anything else that we missed that you want to find out about? Or you want to talk to us? You want to get in touch with the show? It's easy to do. We're on Twitter at FGGGbTpod. We're on Facebook at FGGGbT. But you can get in touch with us individually. Denon, where can people find you?
Well, they can find me on Twitter and Instagram. That's just flip my name and it's at Denon Michael. And then if you want to find me on Facebook, you stick a prof in there. It's at prof Denon Michael.
Ben, where can people find you?
You can find me on all the major social media networks at B Siepser.
How do you spell that?
Spell that B-S-I-E-P-S-E-R.
And I can be found on Twitter at Daniel J. Glenn, on Instagram at The Daniel J. Glenn, and on Facebook at Analytical Mastermind. And if you want to get in touch with the show via email for questions, correspondence, or even a general inquiry, that's questions at FGGGbt.com.
And if you're listening on your favorite podcast platform, make sure to rate and review and double check that you're subscribed.
And if you're watching us on YouTube, hit the like button, subscribe, and ring that bell so you never miss an episode.
And finally, this show contains powerful scientific information that can be misused by those hell-bent on world domination. So you want to be careful with this information. You gotta use it properly because you have a choice before you. Superhero or supervillain, as we say on this show, you want to be a superhero. You don't want to be a supervillain. So until next time, thank you for listening.